Thank you very much for the introduction, and I have it also in written. I would like to thank Andy, Misha, Sergei, and Bang Teng. And since this is recorded, I would like to thank Andy via the recording for this conference. I don't remember any conference in recent time where I found a more appealing program, so I really appreciate this program of this conference, and I found all the talks so far very exciting and interesting, I have to say. Here's my table of contents. I would like to introduce hypergroups very briefly. It's a very simple definition which I would like to present. I would like to talk about twinned Coxeter hypergroups. This is a technical term for something which is kind of more general than twin buildings, but from a different point of view, and the motivation for introducing hypergroups comes basically from this second section. After that, I'm interested in number four, complements in association schemes. So in a general theory of association schemes, you may want to know when a closed subset has a complement in the spirit of the Schur-Zassenhaus theorem. And in order to motivate that, I review a couple of things which many of you know already about general structure theory of association schemes, and actually there are also co-authors and authors about this. But maybe for people who have not yet seen the general structure theory of association schemes, there might be a couple of new results in chapter number three. But chapter number three, or section number three, is really old business. What is a hypergroup? We start with a set S and a map from the Cartesian product S cross S to the power set of S. And we assume always that the image of this, of every pair is not empty. So every pair of elements is mapped to a subset of S. Well, the subset might be a singleton, in which case we have an ordinary operation on the set. We abbreviate the image just by P times Q, so we have a multi-product, so to speak, on S, so just P times Q. In a group, P times Q is a single element. Here it's just a set of 10 elements, or 12 elements, or infinitely many elements. If I write capital letters for two subsets, P and Q of S, I mean the union of the products which are introduced here, where the P comes from P and the Q comes from Q. So you may think of the complex product in group theory, of course. And an abbreviation is obviously the product where one of the two capital letters is a singleton, in which case we just write the element S from S times the subset R, so that it looks more like a coset in group theory. S is called a hypergroup with respect to this hyper operation, mu, like multiplication, if we have associativity. And in order to state associativity, I need this product here, of course, because the parenthesis is already a subset. So I need to know what it means to multiply a single element times a subset. Therefore, I preponed this definition here. But then I can state what associativity means, and I want that as a first defining rule for a hypergroup. Secondly, I have a neutral element. So if I multiply S, any element S in S times that element, I get a product which consists of a single element, namely that element S by itself. And then number three says that if you have three elements in S, well, I should say for every element S there exists an inverse, I would call it inverse, of course, so that for any three elements this implication holds. So what does it mean? If P is in the product of the inverse Q of times the inverse of R, then cyclically we get the same thing if we rotate. So Q goes to the first place, R to the second place, P to the last place. The stars stay where they are. And if you read the element symbol here as equal and the star as minus one, then this is just what you know from group theory. If you multiply, by R from the right-hand side and by P inverse from the left-hand side, then you get this here. So this replaces, so to speak, what we have in group theory, the inverse element. Is that an easy and, I think, a straightforward setting? So that's what we, what I call, actually what Frédéric Marty called hypergroup in 1934. And he also added commutativity. So he also requested that P times Q equals Q times P, which I thought is probably not really needed because nobody would think that a group is by definition commutative. So why should the hypergroup be commutative right from the
beginning? There are many different definitions also of hypergroups, and most of them, I really learned this term only when I was looking at association theory, but there are thick books about hypergroups, and I believe you probably know these books. Mostly, as far as I know, statistics content. So there's a measure defined on S, and then people basically investigate the measure with this hypergroup. But the abstract definition of a hypergroup, as far as I know, has not yet received too much attention. I don't know a single paper except from the original paper where really people just look at, let me say, combinatorial hypergroups in this sense. So plain hypergroups without anything else. First observation, densitization teams are hypergroups. And for that, let me remind you of the definition of densitization team. Densitization team is a set X, and the partition on the Cartesian product X cross X, and then S is called a densitization team, or specifically a scheme, if the identity on X is one of the binary relations which belongs to S. Whenever we have an element in S, then also the converse relation or the inverse relation, which is defined here, also must belong to S. But then we have this regularity condition, which everybody has seen already a couple of times on this conference and maybe also in other places. I do not assume here commutativity or symmetricity, so I'm not saying that S star is equal to S for any element S in S. I'm not assuming that APQR equals AQPR, and you even may have noticed that I didn't really reveal where the APQR comes from. So I'm not saying this is an H number here, so it also could be any cardinal number which is infinite for the time being. Of course, sometimes I have to restrict myself to assuming that these numbers are finite numbers, and this is of course the most interesting case. And if you have an association scheme, you take two relations from the association scheme. So that could be the partition notation, maybe R1 times R2 or Ri times Rj. Then, of course, you get in the convex product a bunch of elements in S, a bunch of relations, namely those that the structure constant is not zero.
So if you like, or if you prepare to view an association scheme as an associative algebra, or as a Bose-Messner algebra, then the product P times Q would be just the set of all relations which are in the support of the product of the two matrices which belong to these relations. I'm not quite sure whether I have to do something with this here, but no. I probably just put it here. Good, anyway, and you may expect that this is the product which makes an association scheme to be a hypergroup, and that's exactly what it is. So it's easy to verify the three axioms for a hypergroup for this product, which I usually call the complex product of P and Q. Then it's very easy to check that S, the association scheme S defined on X, is a hypergroup. So every association scheme is a hypergroup, and hypergroup is, so to speak, an association scheme without X. So if I could say it a little bit more blasphemic to H. E. Banai, who always says scheme theory is, what does he say, group theory without groups, then one could say that hypergroup theory is scheme theory without schemes. That would be the right generalization of that quotation. Anyway, everybody knows that groups are association schemes, so in particular groups are hypergroups, and you may have expected that. Question is, what are the hypergroups? They are easy to characterize. What are the groups? They are easy to characterize within the class of all hypergroups. First observation from rule number 3 for hypergroups is that the identity element, which I denoted by E previously, and now of course I call just 1, is contained in the complex, in the product S star times S, and then an element S is called thin if that product contains only one element, namely the identity. And if all elements are thin, then the hypergroup turns out to be a group. The set of all thin elements, which might be different from S, of course, is denoted by O sub theta of S, theta like thin. And I call it the thin radical of the hypergroup. Good. Well, if you want to look at hypergroups from an abstract point of view, you want to see whether what you can generalize from group theory to hypergroup theory. And I just go through very basic things. Of course, you may define what a closed subset is to mimic the notion of a subgroup. It's a non-empty subset of S, and you want that the product of any two elements, where the first is the inverse of the second one, is, well, in group theory you have your element in T, and here we have to write it's a subset of T for any two elements which come from T already. If T is finite, if S is finite, you may even drop the star like in group theory. If you have a closed subset which generalizes the notion of a subgroup, then you may want to look at quotient structures. Well, in group theory, everybody knows that you can define quotient groups only if you have a normal subgroup. In scheme theory, if you have a closed subset, it's easy to see that you can factorize, then you can factor out every closed subset. You don't need to factor out a normal closed subset, whatever that means. You stay inside the same category of association schemes. That's a big advantage in scheme theory towards against group theory, and makes sometimes induction proofs much easier than in group theory, where you first have to look for a normal subgroup in order to apply. Anyway, so that's the same in hypergroup theory. This is clear what it means. It's just a complex product of capital T times little s times capital T. So it's just a subset of S. And I just abbreviate it by S to the T. And then I take the set of all these double cosets, so to speak. And then I have to define a product on the set of all these double cosets. And it's defined like this. It's a set of all double cosets, which are contained in the five-fold complex product T times P times T times Q times T. Well, I can omit the T, of course, because if R to the T is in this, then it is in the five-fold product and vice versa. And then this is, of course, a map from this Cartesian product to the power set. And you just check whether this is a hypergroup again. And that is an easy exercise to see that, in fact, it is. So for every closed subset, we have a hyperquotient group or hyperfactor group, if you want, with respect to the multiplication which I defined here. It's also clear what a normal subset is. It's just a set which satisfies this condition here. This was defined earlier, so this is defined similarly. And if these two subsets of S are equal, then I would call T a normal closed subset. But as I said, in order to define quotients, I don't need normality for the sub-hypergroup which I want to factor out. Well, and then we define what a homomorphism is, in the same way as in group theory. It's clear what the kernel of a homomorphism is. And then one can easily establish the homomorphism theorem for hypergroups, the first isomorphism theorem for hypergroups, and the diamond theorem, as people say in America, or the second isomorphism theorem, as Emmy Noether called it. And that is all a very formal business and works like in group theory. And from there, one can, of course, also try to find whether there's a Jordan-Hölder theory, whatever you want. Well, I'm interested in a very specific situation which might occur in hypergroups. I would like to describe how closed subsets look like, which are spanned by an arbitrary subset. And I just mimic what I know from group theory, of course. So if S is a hypergroup and I take an arbitrary subset R of S, then by R in this type of acute brackets, I mean the intersection of all closed subsets of S which contain R, like I do this in group theory. And then it is also clear what an involution is in hypergroup theory. It's an element which in the first place is different from the identity. And if I put this element together with the identity in a box, that box is closed. It's a closed subset. Or equivalently, the span of S has order 2, like in group theory. Now I take a set of involutions and call it L. So not necessarily only one involution, but let's say 12 involutions. And I look at the span of these 12 involutions, and then I have a lemma which is similar to group theory. This is nothing but the union of the sets L to the N, where N runs through the non-negative integers. Yeah? L to the N is clear what it is. I mean, L times L is the complex product, which I defined on the first slide. L times L to the third is L times L times L, and inductively you define L to the N for all, N in N. And then you prove, like in group theory, that the span of L is nothing but the union of all these complex products. And that gives rise to the length function of any element in the span. So if I pick an element S in the span of L, then it must be in one of the L to the N. So I take the smallest exponent so that that element S is in S L to the N, and I call that the length of that element, like it is done in group theory. In group theory, of course, this here is a single element usually, but here it's not necessarily that this is a single element here, but if an element S is contained in L to the 7 and not contained in L to the 6 or 5, then I just call the length of that element 7. So that also makes sense to define like in group theory. So we don't need association schemes for this, we don't need groups for that, just the notion of a hypergroup is enough. Easy to see if we have a product of two elements, P and Q, in the span of L. Well, then P has probably length 5 and Q has length 4. And if R is in the product, then the length of R must be less than 5 plus 4. Yeah, if I have, that's what why I wanted to show this here on this screen. It's clear if we have an element, I called it here P, and it has length 4, that means I have here 4 involutions, so that that element P is contained in the product of the first involution times the second involution times the third times the fourth involution in capital L. And if Q has length 5, that means I have a path of length 5 from here to there, and then the element R, which is in the product P times Q, has an arc, so to speak, of length 9. That means the length of R is at most 9. It could be smaller, of course. It also could be that we have an element R1 in the product P times Q, which has length 7, and another one has length 8. So everything is possible at that point. But the elements in R cannot have length 10, because 10 is bigger than 5 plus 4. And it is, of course, interesting to see what happens if the length of an element in the product is exactly the sum of the two lengths. So what happens if we have an element in R which has exactly length 9? That might happen, but it might also happen that this never occurs. And in fact, it does sometimes. So I would like to give a name to the elements which have that property. So if S is a hypergroup, and let's assume that S is generated by a set of involutions, and I call that set again L, let's say of 3 involutions or 12 involutions, then I say that P pushes Q if there exists an element R in the product which has the maximal possible length. Yeah? So that's here in this picture. So if R has length 9, then I would say that P pushes, that must be a Q, pushes Q. Yeah, because that element here is as far away from this element as possible. It has distance 9, so to speak. So P pushes Q away. And similarly, in the same situation, I say that R pulls Q. Yeah? So here's R, here's Q, and if this has length 5 and R has length 9, then I get this point as close as possible to this point as possible, as close as possible to this point. Yeah? It might be that I have this point here further away, but if R attracts, or if it pulls Q to this point, then that means that I have to go 4 steps from here to there and 5 steps really from there to here. So an element in the span may push or may pull another element in the span. And if I fix an element Q, then L1Q is a set is a notation for the set of all P in the span which push Q away. And minus 1 is a set of all R which pull Q to the origin. Good. There's one situation which might be interesting. If you have two elements, P and Q, and P pushes Q, well, that means that if P has length 4 and Q has length 5, then that means there's at least one element in the product which has length 9. If I request that the product consists only of one element and P pushes Q, then this only element has length 9, because there must be an element of length 9, and there's only one element, so that means it's 9. If that happens for any two elements P and Q, then I call L constraint. Yeah? So constraintness is just a property of a set of involutions in a hypergroup, that's all. Yeah? Take your favorite hypergroup, assume it's spanned by a collection of involutions, then it may be that this set is constrained or not. Well, it's constrained if exactly this last condition holds, namely that if you have two elements in the span, and if the first pushes the second, then the product consists of a single element, and that element must then necessarily have length of P plus length of Q. That's the only definition. Now I come to the exchange condition. You can phrase the exchange condition also purely hypergroup theoretically. And the situation says the condition says this. I also draw a picture for that. So we have two elements in L, and I call them H and K. So H is an involution. It's one of the generators. And K is also one of the generators. And we have another element which is in the span. So that is S here, in the span. And S has length, whatever, 5 or 4 or 0 or 1. It's an arbitrary element in the span of L. So now I assume that H pushes S. Okay, what does that mean? That means this, here we have an element. Oh, let's just assume that S has length 4. Then this, there must be an element in the product H times S which has length 5. That means that H pushes S and S pushes K, so we also have this. Then again we have an element there, and if we additionally assume that L is constrained, then that means this is the only element of length 5 in the product S times K, and similarly here. Then the question is, what is this here? And the condition says that either HS was this animal here, is equal to SK, which is this element here, or HS pushes K. Well, HS is this here, pushes K means that this here, this element here, let's say R, has length 6, has length 4 plus 1 plus 1. Well, it's just a condition. But it turns out that this condition is the exchange condition which defines Coxeter groups. And once we have defined what an involution is in hypergroup theory, the definition makes sense also for hypergroups, not only for groups. So we can speak about Coxeter hypergroups, so to speak. So a Coxeter hypergroup is hypergroup S, which is generated by a bunch of involutions. We assume that L is constrained, and L also satisfies the exchange condition. And question is whether we can do something with that. Well, we can prove a couple of lemmas and try to mimic everything what one knows from Coxeter group theory. And one thing which one can prove in Coxeter groups is this equation here. If we take subsets of L, so J is a set of, let's say, three generators. Here is another set of five generators. And if we take the intersection of the generators and conjugate it by an arbitrary element S, then that's the same as conjugation of the first intersected with the conjugation of the second. Of course, in general, that's by no means true. Even if you just take L a set of involutions, it's not true. I mean, the left-hand side is always contained in the right-hand side, but the right-hand side by no means is contained in the left-hand side. But in Coxeter groups, it's a case. For Coxeter groups, it's not easy to prove. But for Coxeter hypergroups, well, it's a little bit more involved. You have to show that, but it just works. A second proposition or lemma would be if one has a Coxeter hypergroup and we assume that there is no thin element in S. So there's no, I defined previously what thin means. Thin means that S star times S contains only the identity. So we assume that, of course, the identity itself is always thin. But if we assume that there's no non-identity thin element, So if you assume that the thin radical of the hypergroup S is trivial, I would say, then there's a bijection from the power set of L to the set of all closed subsets of S. So if you take the 2 to the n subsets of L, where n is the cardinality of L, then there are exactly 2 to the n closed subsets which are spanned by the elements from K. And you know that result, of course, from groups of Lie type. If you look at the supergroups, the groups which are on between G and the Borel subgroup, then they are exactly, the parabolic subgroups are exactly, they have the same, they form a complete lattice, so to speak. Yeah? You cannot have two different subsets and they give you the same subgroup. You cannot have two different subsets of L which give you the same subgroup sitting between G and the Borel subgroup. Well, usually you prove that for groups of Lie type, but you don't need that. You have that already for hypergroups. And Wang, who's also here, is trying to mimic these things all for the class of table algebras. I probably should have mentioned that table algebras are also hypergroups. Table algebras in the logical row are sitting between association schemes and hypergroups. Yeah? So you first have groups, then you have association schemes without X, so to speak, but with an underlying field is table algebra theory, and hypergroup theory is just the looking at the basis of the standard basis of an table algebra, but forgetting the field, not dealing with the extra conditions which you have on the hand of by the fact that you have an underlying field. Good. Okay, here's an application to association schemes. The general idea of Coxeter schemes is that I believe, or that's the term in which I think, and many of you know that, of course, is that the Coxeter schemes play in scheme theory the same role as Coxeter groups play in group theory. So there's a nice analogy between everything what you can do, what you can say about Coxeter groups within Coxeter within group theory, you can say about Coxeter schemes within scheme theory. So that's a general idea. I haven't defined here Coxeter schemes, but what is a Coxeter scheme? It's of course an association scheme, so that the underlying hypergroup is a Coxeter hypergroup. So that is a natural definition for a Coxeter scheme. But in a Coxeter scheme, of course, you also have the underlying set X. Well, the reason for the interest in Coxeter schemes is that Coxeter schemes are basically buildings. And by basically, I mean there's a well-understood one-to-one correspondence between Coxeter schemes and buildings. Roughly speaking, for those who have never seen that before, the X is a set where the chamber system is defined on. So if you view a building as a chamber system, then X, the set where the association scheme is defined on, that is a set of the chambers in the chamber system. And then you just have to define the relations which arise from a building and have to identify them with the relations which are defined by the association scheme, which gives the Coxeter schemes. So this is, so to speak, the reason why I'm interested in Coxeter schemes. And this proof is actually via coset geometries, as Titz introduced them for groups. But you can define coset geometries also for association schemes. You don't need groups for that. And I just mimicked Titz's idea and put that in a preprint series of the Max Planck Institute in Bonn, where I stayed for a while, and just among other things, I put that result into there because it never appeared in one of my two books. So I put that result into those notes. Well, and then you might recognize this theorem here, of course. If S is a Coxeter scheme, and if it is a finite Coxeter scheme, that means that S is finite, so finite rank. And if you have at least three generators, and you assume that the thin radical is trivial again, then S is Schurian, and I will explain in a short while what I mean by a Schurian association scheme. And that is, of course, the theorem by Titz about buildings of spherical type. Here you see the spherical, here you see rank at least three, and here you see the condition which Titz also needs in order to establish his theorem, that in that case the building comes from a group. That means literally Schurin. So what I was interested in is to find a proof different from Titz's proof, of course, and also different from the proof which appeared meanwhile in the book of Weiss via he had a proof which is based on chamber systems. I mean, his proof is based on the same idea as the original proof of Titz, but he translated everything to chamber systems, and I was still not happy with that, so I thought it's probably a good idea to translate it just to hypergroups or to association schemes, because then you just, for a long while, you just compute like in group theory with S, and that's all, and only at the very end you need to go concretely into X and work with dots and lines. So for a long time you can really work with on the basis of S, and that's why I looked at hypergroups. And if you look at Titz's theorem and prove as much as you can via hypergroups, then you have already 60 or 70% of the proof, and only at the very end you have to make your hands dirty and go into the geometric little things and to fiddle around why at the end you find that group. Yeah. So that was my interest, that was one of my motivations to look at hypergroups. To say it once again very briefly, the original proof by Titz really is to a big extent just a hypergroup theory proof, and the two lemmas which I mentioned contribute to that proof. Good. Titz has not only investigated, as you know, just simple buildings, but he, after that main theorem which I mentioned, he got mainly interested in buildings of affine type, and after that in twin buildings or twinned buildings. And I believe that it is possible to also describe affine buildings scheme theoretically, but what I am not really, what I do not really see is how twin buildings enter the theory of association schemes. In other words, what is the right notion of, or which association schemes really represent the twin buildings in exactly the same way as the Coxeter schemes describe or characterize the buildings, the simple buildings. And I would like to give you a very rough impression how that works. It's only one direction. So I have a construction where I get twin buildings, but I don't know how to get back, so to speak, from an arbitrary twin building to an association scheme. Well, again, I can start with a hypergroup, and for a long time it's enough to think hypergroup theoretically. You don't need to even to go to association schemes, and that's what I want to show here. So what I do is I start with a hypergroup, I take a set of involutions, and important is I have a map from the span of L to S. So I'm not saying anymore that L spans S. I just take a couple of involutions and I take the closed subset which is generated by L, by these involutions. And I need a map into S itself. Well, it could be the natural injection or whatever you want, but then it could be any other injective map. It only has one condition, and the condition is this. Well, first of all, I call M the image of 1. Well, this is a closed subset. That means the 1 is in the span. So row of 1 makes sense, or 1 to the row makes sense. I call that element M. And what I need is now that the product R to the M times R, well, in general, this is a subset of S. So that could be a big set. So it's a very big constraint that I just assume it's only one element. And which one? Exactly that M, for all R. So it's a very, very restricted situation. Yeah. So for every R in the span of L, I want that the product is exactly this element. Well, this situation occurs actually, and that is the prototype where Titz got his idea, of course, from. If you take a finite Coxeter scheme, or just think of a Coxeter group, a finite Coxeter group, then M is the uniquely determined element of maximal length. In a finite Coxeter group, you have always one and only one element of maximal length. Take that element, that is the M actually. And then the map rho, which I generalized here, is a map which assigns to every element in the Coxeter group its complement, so to speak.
Yeah, if you have some element of longest length, call it M, and you take an arbitrary element in a Coxeter group, let's say S, then there exists exactly one element S rho, so that S rho times S is equal to M, and the sum of the length of S rho and the length of S is the maximal length, the length of M. So that is the map in finite Coxeter group theory or in finite Coxeter scheme theory. But there might be another map. It must not be this one. And that's what Titz was looking at. And then it's interesting to see that the image of this map, the image of this map, of this row, is nothing but a coset of the subgroup or the subhypergroup we started with. So it's a map from the closed subset L, span of L, into a coset, namely the coset which has representative M. So this map is very much under control. Well, so that's a setup again. And well, this is just to give you an impression what the first thing is. I mean, you want to know what is the image of the inverse of Q. Yeah, and then if that is contained in the image of the inverse of P times a generator, then you get this. So you can ask yourself, what happens if they are in the same coset? Well, then the length of the first is smaller than the length of the second. What happens if the lengths are equal? Then even the two elements are equal. So these are lemmas which all follow very straightforwardly from the setup. Well, here's more. Oh no, wait. This is, okay, so here is now where the twinning comes into the game. So for the twinning, we need two subsets of involutions. We need two sets of involutions. So that is the capital L from the previous slide. Here's another capital L. So we need the row from the span of L to S, but we also need a second map from the span of the other set of involutions to S, and both must be injective. And remember, Q to the row times Q was the singleton M in the previous case, and we need here also that P times P to the lambda is also a single element, and these two elements are the same. We need that. That's an assumption. So rho stands for right and lambda stands for left. So here you see that the P to the lambda is on the right-hand side, and here the Q to the rho is on the left-hand side. So probably I should have switched the notation for lambda and rho. But anyway, that's a twinning. So one comes from the right-hand side and the other one comes from the left-hand side. And we need that this unique element here, which is the M, the right coset of M with respect to H is equal to the left coset of K with respect of M with respect to K. Well, that's something which just gives you a group theoretic feel. I mean, it's just you have that in group theory millions of times. You have two subgroups and you look for cosets, and it might happen that two cosets coincide. So it's just a group theoretic condition here. Then again, you can play around with this, and you get a lot of conditions. And the only thing I want to say in this situation is that, again, for a long time, you can play around with this without even thinking about X. X is a set where the association scheme is defined on. This is just here hypergroup theory. So there's no association scheme and by no means a geometry involved. Yeah? So it's just plain hypergroup theory. And at the end, of course, one has, again, to go down to X, and that's what I did here. We take two elements Y and Z in X, and we take two elements which are in the relation M, which was the generalization of the longest of the element of longest length in a finite Coxeter group, and then we take the union of all. So that is literally just taking the idea of Titz and translate it into association scheme theory. And then it turns out that this here is an apartment, and the secret of the twin buildings is that the apartments of one of the buildings are mapped one-to-one to the apartments of the other. So there's an opposite apartment. And the one-to-one correspondence is achieved by this M here. Well, I gave you the general definition of an apartment in an association scheme. I don't want to go through these things here in detail. I just want to give you the impression that that if you take an apartment of this and an apartment of that, then for one apartment, which is created by one of the buildings, always is associated in a one-to-one way to an apartment of the other one. And if you have that, then it's well, kind of clear how to construct the twin building. So this was just an idea how to get twin buildings at least from a, so here we need an association scheme. So I think I didn't say that. As soon as I start here talking about X and Z, Y and Z, I need an underlying set X. So from here on, I talk about association schemes. And what I wanted to say is that it is possible to construct twin buildings inside very specific association schemes. What I was not able to manage so far is to see whether twin buildings always arise in this way. But this looks very natural, so I, since many years, I'm very confident that it also goes the other way around, but I haven't yet found a way, and I would like to speak in the spirit of Sasha to ask you for help in this question. But anyway, now I would like to go a little bit faster over this here, structure theory of association schemes. As I said, I mean, most people here in the audience know what I'm talking about. I subdivide the theory into a local theory, like in group theory, where pseudo-theorem are the starting point of a local theory. Representation theory is a relatively independent part of group theory, as group theorists always agree. And the third part, which makes the group theory complete, is the theory of generators or the theory of geometries. So my teacher Bender always told me that if you want to prove a big theorem in group theory, then the first thing is always look at the maximal subgroups. If they give you a decent geometry, then you can focus on that geometry. But after a while, that doesn't tell you anymore anything. So then you have to go to the local to the local theory. You have to look what are the Zulu subgroups. Can you say something about the Zulu subgroups of the maximal subgroups? And then you can play with the, well, Bender did that, of course, with the generalized fitting subgroup. But at a certain point, and the order paper shows that, of course, you end up where even the local theory doesn't tell you anything anymore. So you have the so-called three-step groups, or if you go just for the nilpotent version of the order paper, you have Frobenius groups. And then Veit came into the game and says, okay, we have to look at the Frobenius, in the case, for the nilpotent case, we know what the characters of the Frobenius groups are. But in the three-step subgroups, we have to develop the, he developed the theory of where he found isometries between the original irreducible characters and the induced characters of the three-step subgroups. So this is the, what is it called, the theory of the induced exceptional characters, applying the, which basically, the fundamental thing is the Brouwer-Suzuki lemma. That's probably the keyword for that. Yeah? So that's the three steps, if that's what I'm saying. So Bender always told me, if you want to prove a big theorem in group theory, you have to go this step. At the end, the character theory kills a counterexample. Then at the end you get 2 equals 3 and then the counterexample doesn't exist. So his point of view was always this. Representation theory is the most specific, local theory is the mid-size, and this is the first idea. So I thought maybe it's a good idea to view schemes, association schemes, also under that perspective. Anyway, so, well, subschemes, quotient schemes, it's clear how to define these things. X times T, so I'm here in an association scheme. S is a scheme on X, T is a closed subset, and then X times T is a set of all T neighbors, T is a relation, and X to the capital T is of course the set of all, the union of all these X times little t, where T comes from T, and then if you restrict T to this part of the partition, you know that these sets here form a partition of X, then if you put these things together, then that thing here is an association scheme on XT. Some people call that a subscheme defined on this equivalence class. And similarly, you can define quotient schemes, and that mimics literally what I said already for hypergroups. And then it's easy to see that this set here is also an association scheme, and that's called the quotient scheme over that subscheme, or just over T. And as I mentioned before, in order to define quotient schemes, you don't need to deal with normal closed subsets. Well, again, you get an homomorphism theorem, you get an isomorphism theorem, you get theorem of Jordan-Hölder. And as I said, well, I mentioned this already two times, factorization is possible. What is really missing is something which generalizes the generalized fitting subgroup for association schemes in order to get a hold on the maximal closed subsets in an arbitrary association scheme. So that is one of the topics which I discussed with Chris French, who is recently interested in association schemes, and he by himself asked this question. So that seems really to be something which should be in the center of the interest if one really wants to say something general about finite association schemes. I would briefly talk about surety because it was already mentioned in one or the other way in previous talks. If we start with a set again and an association scheme on the set X, then thin means that the valency, so that is the ki in the language of commutative scheme theoreticians, is always one. That element is an element is called thin if or linear in table algebra theory if the valency is one, and then an association scheme is called Schurian if S is the quotient of a thin scheme. So if you start with a thin scheme, which is literally a group, and if you factor out an arbitrary group, then that quotient scheme is called Schurian. There are different ways to introduce Schurian scheme, but I think it's a very convincing way of defining schemes, and it's clear that Schurian... so there's a mistake here. Thin implies Schurian, not the other way around. And here are different ways to say what it means for S to be Schurian. We could phrase it this way, that we say that the automorphism group of S is transitive on each of the relations. So that means if you take two elements in X and they are related via a relation, let's say capital R10, then there must exist an automorphism which sends it to any other two relations which are in relation R10, or little s, as I prefer to say. Another way to say it is that the automorphism group is first of all transitive on the vertices, and secondly, the vertex stabilizer is transitive on the S neighbors of X. That's the same as doubly transitive. It's an exercise in algebra. Yeah? Doubly transitive means that, you mentioned that, that any two elements different from each other can be mapped to any other two elements, but that's of course the same as if we would say the group is transitive and acts and the one-point stabilizer acts transitively on all neighbors. Well, here it cannot act transitively on all neighbors, but on all S neighbors, and that for every S, of course. Another way to say what Schurian means is this. Each faithful map from this tiny little set to X extends to a full automorphism. Well, what does faithful mean? Faithful means that a map faithful applies to a map from a subset of X to X. So if you take a subset of X and you take two elements from this subset and they are in relation S, then the image should also be in relation S. So the S is preserved. That's why faithful. So, if you start with a big set, which is already faithful, and you want to extend that to a full automorphism, that's probably not so difficult, because you have already a big chunk which is faithful. And an automorphism is, of course, a faithful map from X to X. But what we need is we need to extend from every tiny little set just consisting of two elements. That is extendable to an automorphism of S. And that is exactly what the definition which Titz used in his proof. Yeah? So that's most likely the working definition, so to speak. The other definitions are beautiful, but this is the one you really work with. Good, and I mentioned that already a couple of times in other talks. I believe that it's very challenging and appealing to me to see. Give me a condition and I can prove under this condition a scheme is Schurian. And there are theorems. And then if it is Schurian, tell me what the group is and what the subgroup is. And then I understand that scheme because I probably know this subgroup is a very specific subgroup which I know from group theory. And one of these theorems is the condition where we assume that all valencies are one or two. And then we have an extra condition, which I do not want to talk about here, a natural extra condition. Then a scheme is Shurian, and it is the quotient of, well, Shurian means that it is a quotient of a group. So which group? In that case, it's the, what is the subgroup? In that case, the subgroup is just an involution. It's a subgroup of order 2. So which involution is it? Is it any involution? No, it's an involution which gives rise to a Z-star group in the sense of Glaubermann. So in this case, we know exactly what the groups are which make these schemes Shurian. Yeah? You see, this situation here, this condition here is also very natural. I mean, if all Ns are equal to 1, then every group is of that type. So these are just the groups. So you may ask, and that was Mrs. Chuk's idea, to ask what happens if we assume just that Ns is 1 or 2. Can we say that these schemes are also Shurian? Well, under this extra condition, they are Shurian. And we know exactly what the groups are which give rise to these Shurian. And by Z star group, I mean the following. You may guess that if you take an involution in an arbitrary finite group and you take a conjugate of that, that's another involution. Well, the span is a dihedral group, of course. So if that group has order 2 times odd, so in other words, if the product of the involution you start with times the conjugate is an element of odd order, that is equivalent to what I said previously, for any conjugate, then that is a so-called isolated involution. And these are exactly the Glaubermann involutions I'm talking about. Yeah? So this is exactly the situation which we at which we arrive if we assume that all the Ns are less than or equal to 2. And after we published this, Mr. Chuk, together with Ilya, had another condition. They were able to drop this condition, and they could say, well, almost always we get a Shurian association scheme. They are almost always Shurian, and they say explicitly what groups they get and when they do not get. So they are not always Shurian, but they know exactly when they are Shurian. So I don't want to state this theorem here. What I want to say is that Tit's theorem is also just a recognition theorem in this sense. Yeah? It just says, okay, take a finite Coxeter group, take two extra conditions, namely that the thin radical is trivial and that rank is at least 3, then the scheme is Shurian. And then he says, well, which group is it? It's a group of whatever it is, a group of Lie type, and you factor out the Borel subgroup, period. So it's also a theorem in this sense, if you like to see it this way. There are many theorems, but what I also found very appealing is you just may assume, just for fun, that all the elements are involutions except from the identity, like an elementary abelian group. Well, in association scheme theorem, Edwin found out that S is Shurian and actually the quotient of an affine group. So that's also a theorem in this spirit, so to speak. So I thought this is interesting to see how recognition theorems look like. I do not want to go too much over Zülow's theorems. Those who know the theorem or the result know all this, and those who don't probably need a while to see what the setup is. So if you agree that there's a Zülow theorem for association schemes, then I'm happy with that message. And that result first was proved by Hirasaka together with Misha and myself, and then for a table algebra, it was proved by Blau and myself. So finite p-valenced schemes have Zülow p-subsets, whatever p-valenced means, and we also have the conjugation and the number of Zülow p-subsets condition which one has in group theory. So this is a genuine generalization of Zülow's theorem in finite group theory. At the end, I would like to briefly mention that what I said in the beginning, schemes are defined usually on finite sets, of course, and then the arithmetic really works. But you also can think of association schemes on infinite sets, and then you have to impose some constraints. If you want to impose constraints on S, that's what I did here on that screen. So I said they must satisfy the exchange condition. Then you can talk about Coxeter schemes and you get results. You get a surety result. And recently I found a paper on the archive by Alexander Bark and Skriganov, and they go the other way around. They have a constraint on X, and they assume that X satisfies certain conditions. And what they do, I guess you're talking about that in your talk more explicitly, they assume that X is a generalized or a measure space, so to speak. And they also get results in that case, but of course not like in group theory. I mean, if you just don't assume anything about an infinite group, there's not very much to say. Anyway, so I would like to conclude this. And now I would like to ask how many minutes I still have. A couple of minutes. Okay, and I take advantage of a couple of minutes. I go back to finite association schemes. So X is finite, and I would like to define solvability of finite association schemes. Well, we just take the commutator. I defined this in the very first. Like in group theory, we take the span of those, and then we get this. And of course, S prime, S is an association scheme, is just this, the commutator of S with itself. And it is easy to see that the thin radical is nothing but the span of all commutators S, 1. So in other words, the thin radical is contained in the derived scheme. Yeah? This is a subset of that, because this is the span of all of those. So just by looking at the definition. That means that S prime contains O theta of S. That's what I have here. And it is easy to see that S prime is strongly normal in S. It's a variation of the normality which I defined previously. And then I can look at the quotient scheme, and it turns out that the quotient scheme is thin and commutative, like in group theory. And a scheme, well, could be called solvable if every closed subset different from 1 is different from its derived subscheme, like in group theory. I would like to talk about the transversal and complements of closed subsets. If we have an association scheme and we have a closed subset, well, in group theory, we would like to know under which hypothesis do we have a complement. And complement, it's also clear what that means. And it also is clear what a transversal is. So if T is a closed subset of S, then a transversal of T in S is a set R which intersects every coset, let's say left coset here, in exactly one element for every element in S. What is a complement? A complement is of T in S is just a closed subset U, so that the intersection is 1, and the complex product, which I defined already on the hypergroup level, is equal to S. And of course, a complement is nothing but a closed transversal, like in group theory. Well, we also can define transversals of T in X. Well, remember this here is by definition the set of all T neighbors of X, where T is an element in capital T. So we know that this is a partition of X, so we pick one element of each part of the partition and call that a transversal of T in X. So in scheme theory, you have two transversals per closed subset, one transversal in X and one transversal in S. And then I can state the theorem, which I recently proved with Chris French from Iowa. If you have a solvable normal closed subset of S, and if you assume that the order of T and the order of the quotient scheme are co-prime. So that is what we have in group theory. Yeah? If you take a normal subgroup, which is Hall, this here represents Hall. Yeah? The order, as you explained, the order of the subgroup T is co-prime to the index of the subgroup of T. So this is nothing but the index. If you assume that, then T has a complement in S. Well, that would be the nicest version, but it's just not true. This is just the first attempt, and very naive, and everybody finds immediately a counterexample via Ries products. So what we also need to assume is two more things. The first condition is this. Look, this is an intersection number in the quotient scheme. Yeah? The elements in the quotient scheme are something to the T, something to the T, something to the T. So this is an intersection number in the quotient, and I need that all the intersection numbers in the quotient are co-prime to T, to the valency or to the order of T. T is the Hall subscheme, if you want. They must be co-prime.
I don't mind this condition actually, because in the group case, all these guys here are either 1 or 0, because intersection numbers in a group are always 1 or 0. So, and of course, 1 is co-prime to nt, whatever nt is. So this really doesn't hurt. A third condition, and if you just go with this, then still there are counterexamples. So that is definitely not enough. So therefore, we also assume this condition, which says that the product r star times r intersects t only in the identity. And what that says is just the following. Look, I'm talking about r star r. So r star r, sorry, r goes here, r goes there, and that meets t trivially. So we never have two different r neighbors in any coset xt. We never have that. Well, in group theory, you never have that, of course, because in group theory, every element has every element is thin. That means we have only one r neighbor for every element. So already r star r is equal to 1. And in particular, r star r intersected with t is equal to 1. So also that condition doesn't bother me, really. But that's a condition which really makes this proof to work. And what we were able to prove is that then t has a complement in S. And of course, this is a theorem in the spirit of Schur-Zassenhaus. So we try to generalize the Schur-Zassenhaus theorem from group theory to scheme theory. Good. I was planning to go a little bit over this proof, but probably I shouldn't do that too much. What I probably can say is that these two conditions here can be investigated without any, without thinking about transversals or whatever. I mean, you just can take an arbitrary association scheme, take your favorite closed subset, no condition, assume that S normalizes T and that this condition, which I just drew there, is equal to 1. Then you get always bijective maps from one geometric coset to another geometric coset. And these bijections are scheme isomorphisms if T is assumed to be thin. So we have scheme isomorphisms between geometric cosets. Geometric coset is nothing but an equivalence class with respect to a closed subset of the association scheme. So we have hundreds of closed subsets of these equivalence classes. I call them geometric cosets. And from between any of these, there might be an isomorphism from one to the other, as long as we have an S connecting these two geometric cosets. Good. The idea is now that we compose three such cosets. So we have, if we have three times the same situation, then we can go in circuits. We can take a geometric coset, we go first to another one, then to a third one, and then come back to the first one. Well, if you come back to the first one, then that means this is an automorphism of that initial association scheme. So we may wonder what automorphisms are they? Well, there are faithful automorphisms and there are non-faithful automorphisms. And what we needed to prove was that these, oh, I have it on a previous slide, right? Yeah, that they are faithful. But that is a difficult part in that proof. And here's the condition, here's the place where we need this condition here, the coprimitivity. Well, I probably should come to the end by just saying what the setup at the end is. So first of all, we prove the theorem just by assuming that T is thin. And we assume also that T is commutative. And if you remember the proof, the original proof by Schur-Zassenhaus, then Schur also proved the theorem originally only for commutative Hall subgroups. And then it was Zassenhaus who in his book generated by a simple induction proof, which nowadays is done just by Frattini's argument, generalized that. And that's exactly the same thing what we do. So yeah, I would have loved to talk about this. This reminds me very much, this map reminds me very much of the proof by Wieland, who gave a proof for the commutative case. That is exactly in the spirit of that proof. Well, I'm happy to send you a preprint of that if you want to look closer into this. And then we still have assumed that T is thin, and from thin to solvable,
we just go by induction. That's a step which probably everybody could do by himself. We know that T prime is smaller than T, so by induction we may assume that S over T prime satisfies the condition, and then just by induction we get the full theorem which I stated here once again. Interesting, last comment. We need to assume that T is solvable. So the Schulze-Hasenhaus in finite group theory doesn't say if you have a solvable Hall subgroup. But if you want to prove the conjugacy condition, you need solvability. And then people always say, OK, if one of them is solvable, then we have the odd order paper, and then we are happy with that. So I found it kind of strange that in the original we need for the conjugacy condition solvability, and we need it for the existence. And I don't know why. But anyway, we have tried very hard to get rid of this thing, but we're not able to do it in a moment. So I'd like to thank you for your attention.